Let's bow our heads with prayer. Father, we really are living in a universe in which the dialogue and the argument and the controversy has been the dominant issue of the last 6,000 years. Mm. And we recognize that in dialogue and in discussion, we find the nature of God. You are a God who asks, who invites dialogue, who wants to talk.
Yes.
And we recognize that the protest which kind of was brought to the fore 500 years ago this year is unfinished.
Mm.
People have not fully made up their mind as to who is winning the argument.
Yes.
And I pray that as David and I share this week, and as the congregation contributes to the continuing dialogue, that we might see you more brightly, that you may become more attractive, that your justice, your mercy, your love may do something in our hearts and in our minds and transform us so that we would reflect you more brightly as we leave this place. Mm. Give us wisdom, give us clarity, give us insight, give us conviction.
Please.
Lord, please be one of our number, we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
So what's going to happen in our seminar is Glenn and I are going to team teach. And as Glenn mentioned, we'll do 20 minutes of history. This is in round figures. 20 minutes of application and then hopefully 20 minutes of conversation. And we're going to turn the history time over to Glenn, but we'll both be sort of going back and forth. And we're really looking. We already did this morning in my room.
Yeah.
And I just can't wait. I'm enthusiastic. So get us started, Glenn.
Thanks very much. So you would all be well aware that 500 years ago, in 1517, something significant happened.
It's not up there yet.
The Protestant Reformation. Got it here.
I think that might be showing you your next slide.
No, there's a couple of little issues. They'll catch up.
Okay.
So, 500 years ago, 1517, Martin Luther nailed 95 theses to the church door of the castle of Wittenberg. He did it in protest to some of the scandal that was going on in the established church. I do have a picture up there which will appear in the not-too-distant future, from a very famous street artist in England. Does anyone know the name of the famous street artist who runs around in England called Banksy?
Very good.
Heard
very
of Banksy? Good. And Banksy had this to say in one of his little graffiti pictures, which I can see brilliantly, and you'll catch up in a moment. "Speak softly," said Banksy, "but carry a big can of paint." Speak softly, but carry a big can of paint. Sometimes the most important things we need to say are said more conveniently at an arm's length.
Mm.
And Banksy found that he could make political, divisive, and sometimes provocative comments much more brilliantly with his can of paint than he could in person. And in a sense, I think our generation kind of understands the nature of graffiti.
Yeah.
We understand that it's trying to push the comfort zone of people within the society in which it is derived. And in a sense, when I think of Banksy, I think of him as a modern-day Luther. Is that a fair comment?
You said that this morning. I like it.
He's kind of out there, and he's trying to push the boundaries. But Banksy also said something which I found really interesting, and that is, I don't believe in anything. I'm just here for the violence. And one thing David and I do not want to do this week is merely just become sour and cantankerous and obstreperous for the sake of enjoying the violence. We really do want to make some insightful comments and open the tent for dialogue and discussion about issues around the Protestant Reformation, but we certainly don't want to do it just for the violence. People who have observed the Christian church over the last 500 years sometimes have unkindly accused religious ideology as being at the center of all wars, at the center of all trouble. And it's not true empirically, it's not true on an evidence base, but we're often accused of raising issues that are going to generate more heat than light. And that's not our intent today. David and I want, during this week, if you are prepared to share the journey with us, to open for dialogue and discussion and to really examine what is at the basis of the reason why a Catholic monk would nail to the church door at Wittenberg 95 objections to the teachings of the day. As you can see behind us, St. Peter's. Anybody been there? It's a beautiful piece of architecture, isn't it? The Sistine Chapel. Wow, the artwork that is within the Sistine Chapel is absolutely phenomenal. I Googled it to try and work out, what does it cost? What would it cost to replace St. Peter's and the Sistine Chapel. And it's one of those times when you have an aha moment on the internet. Usually you can find anything you want to find.
Yeah.
If you want to find that fluoride's an evil, wicked, terrible poison put in by the Jesuits so that we'll all be seduced into accepting the Sunday law, I can give you 100 links. I'm a dentist, by the way. If you want to discover how evil root canals are, you can find anything you like, from that they are righteousness incarnate to the most offensive procedure known to the medical world. But when you search what is the Sistine Chapel worth, you can't find a figure. It's inestimable in value. No insurance company in the world will give them a premium to replace it. It is one of those things that stands alone. And while we don't know what it is worth now, do you think we have an idea of what it cost? The Sistine Chapel was a very expensive building to build. To raise money for the renovation of St. Peter's Basilica, the Catholic Church promoted a guy called John Tetzel and a lot of his colleagues to go throughout Europe offering good Catholic parishioners the opportunity to buy an indulgence which would give them some relief from the temporal debt that they owed God. At the stage of the medieval church, and I don't think Catholics have distanced themselves too much from this idea, they have the idea that when God forgives our sins, he will remove our guilt, but there will remain a temporal debt that we owe to God.
Yeah.
And that temporal debt can be reduced by saying a Hail Mary or visiting some sacred site or going to a shrine or perhaps doing some act of penance. But if you have not cancelled your temporal debt by the time you die, there is an opportunity to spend a little bit of time in one of heaven's resorts called purgatory for a little while until your temporal debt has been eradicated.
Did you just call that one of heaven's resorts?
Yes. The Catholics have a very, very strange idea about the pleasures God has in store for those he loves. They are perhaps distancing themselves a little bit.
He's saying very funny things, so if you're not picking them up, you're missing it. That was cute. I like that.
They distance themselves a little bit from the idea of purgatory. I've got many Catholic sisters and priests who are my patients, and we have really interesting discussions, David.
But because you, as you do with me,
yeah.
you have basically a captive audience, because you put your hand so far in my mouth.
That's true.
And then you just talk to me, and you say, what do you think of that?
To which my
response is...
Yeah, look, if you're opening that can of worms, we have a little code in our dental notes, so we write VWHF, and it means very high wimp factor, and he's got it in his notes.
Okay, go ahead.
Go ahead. Where are we up to?
Yeah, you were talking about purgatory, one of heaven's lovely resorts.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So the idea was that he would run around and he would grant these indulgences to the saints, and they would buy these indulgences, and it would give them, if we can just go to the next slide, it would give them 10 days release from the temporal debt that they owed purgatory. John Tetzel, this is a photograph of a restored original indulgence from the 15th century, 16th century, and it says, in the authority of all saints and in compassion towards you, I absolve you from all sins and misdeeds and remit all punishment for 10 days. Wow, 10 days less in purgatory. Mm. It's a great benefit. But as the indulgence practice began to accelerate in the 16th century, people started to see that they were going to get much more than 10 days. Let's not bother reading the writing. The idea that we can make a generous donation to St. Peter's Basilica and ourselves, as well as our relatives and those who haven't had this privilege, can be released from purgatory. And instead of making the church holier, people kind of got the idea that forgiveness could be bought and sin could be traded for filthy lucre.
Mm.
And as Martin Luther contemplated the effect on the lives of the parishioners and on the health of the church and on the morality of the nation, he was offended. And so in an attempt to do the equivalent of Banksy, to put up a provocative statement to stimulate discussion in Latin, he drafted, in the language of the intelligentsia, he drafted 95 theses, 95 objections to the sale of indulgences and plastered them on the wall of the church door at Wittenberg. David, were you going to talk to us a little bit about the time in which he lived and why that was such an amazing event and in a moment of history when perhaps in any other moment of history it may not have been as effective?
So one of the things that I hope that Glenn and I are able to accomplish and you in concert with us can accomplish this week will be to give you a sense of who we are. And I just want to talk about the multi-layered identity briefly. So we are here, and I'm making some assumptions, but most of us are here today as Christians, and probably the majority of us as Seventh-day Adventist Christians. And that is not just a thing in itself. That is the end of a long sequence or a series of layers that brings us to where we are as Christians in a Seventh-day Adventist. Let me just walk you through that briefly. So we are, first and foremost, I suppose, theists. That is to say, we believe in God as opposed to those who are atheist, which means the denial of God's existence or an unbelief in the existence of God. So our first level of identity as Seventh-day Adventists is not that we jump immediately to the end of the stream Seventh-day Adventists. We are theists. But then we are even more peculiarly monotheists, because not everybody that believes in God or gods are monotheistic. The three great monotheistic religions, the three best-known monotheistic religions, of course, are Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. And we find ourselves in the stream of monotheism over and against polytheism, over and against pantheism. We say, no, there is one God. He is the creator. So now we have a further clarified identity, not only as theists, but as monotheists, and our next level of identity is we are Christians, right? In that monotheistic legacy and stream, we find ourselves not on the Islamic side of the portrait, not on the Jewish side of the portrait. We find ourselves as Christians, okay? But then for those of us that are here today as non-Catholic Christians, we find ourselves at the next layer of identity, and that's Protestant Christians. We find ourselves as Protestants. And then the next layer after that is as Seventh-day Adventist or whatever denominational affiliation that you have. So sort of think that through. From theist to monotheist to Christian to Protestant, right? Because there are two major divisions. Christianity is bifurcated between Catholicism and Protestantism. And I stand before you today, as does Glenn, and most of you are in this same stream of Protestantism. And what we want to try and highlight in this series is not so much what it means to be a theist, though there could be a time for that, maybe. Not so much what it means to be a monotheist, though there's certainly time for that. Not even so much what it means to be a Christian, though that certainly is implicit in everything we'll talk about. But what it means to be a Protestant.
Yep.
And what better time to celebrate Protestantism and our identity as Protestants than on the 500-year anniversary of the very thing that you see depicted here.
Yeah.
The nailing of the theses to the door at Wittenberg. Now, one more thought on that. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, no, David, I was just going to say, I think we really need to understand that this was a pivotal moment in history. This was a moment where there was an alignment of a whole lot of circumstances that made the protest fly.
So the way that I communicate what Glenn is talking about here, the coalescence of a number of factors that came together to create the perfect storm, the situation was ripe for Luther at this time in this place. And I summarize it in four words, and if you're taking notes, you might want to write these words down. The first thing that the world needed was a mess. A mess. And the church was a mess. Europe is fractured. The Roman Empire is long since past. And within the church, particularly morally, you alluded to that, there was a giant mess, not just of immorality and of scandal, but there was a theological mess, a convoluted labyrinth of church councils and teachings and traditions that were just I suppose to some, a beautiful edifice, but to others, a massively confusing labyrinth. How exactly do I get to God? So you needed a mess, and you had a mess in the middle of the 16th century. The second thing that you needed was a message. And the message can be boiled down to the five solas that we'll be discussing this week, but embryonically, all of the other four solas are contained in the one we're talking about today, and that is Sola Scriptura. Now, I had a church member come up to me this week and say, I don't know what any of that, what are you talking about? You're talking another language. Sola Scriptura is Latin for the Scriptures alone, right? So you needed a mess at this time in Earth's history. You needed a message, and that message was, in two words, Sola Scriptura. Show me, not in the councils, not in the edicts, not in the sayings of popes or of various Catholic councils. What does Scripture say? Number two, you needed a message. Number three, you needed a means. You needed a means. If somebody was saying something of significance 300 years before the time of Luther, it almost certainly would not have had the impact that it did in Luther's day, because a man by the name of Johannes Gutenberg invented something called the movable type printing press in 1439. Actually went through several permutations, but it was sort of actually functional and ready to be used by 1439, which is just under a century from the time that Luther is going to nail his theses to the door in 1517. So not only is Luther going to be writing, not only is he going to be advocating these radical ideas, if you didn't have a way, the internet of the day, to get those radical ideas out into the general circulation, you would have never heard, perhaps, of Martin Luther unless you were, a historian. The fourth thing that you need, so you have a mess, you have a message, you have a means, you need a man. Somebody to stand in the place at this time to say what needs to be said today.
That's
and
right.
In this coalescence of the world in the 16th century, Martin Luther was the man with the message to speak into the mess that was the church at the time.
Yeah, and David, you can't help but just celebrate the subtext.
Yes.
Because we are in a mess. And do we have a message?
Yes, we do.
And do we have the means?
Yes, now we do especially.
And will we be the men and women that God chooses to take into the world to continue what is needed, to continue that dialogue, to continue the argument? And so when Martin Luther nailed his thesis to the wall of the church door in Wittenberg, it was a significant moment in history. It, as David has alluded to, coalesced with a major revolution in every sphere of human endeavor.
Sure.
Architecture was under revolution. Art was under revolution. Scientific revolution.
There was economic revolution.
Machiavelli was making new political statements. The whole of the global experience was at a transition time. It was fluid. The boundaries had been broken down, and it was time to establish a new paradigm. And so Martin Luther comes along at a key point in history, and these, as he would have seen it, this innocuous act of stimulating discussion amongst the intelligentsia by writing in Latin a challenge in a university city to the scholars of Germany and wider Europe suddenly was translated into the lingua franca of the German language and spread all throughout Europe. And there was an amazing response. And within a year of Martin Luther nailing his 95 Theses to the church door in Wittenberg, Pope Leo had to issue a papal bull, and he responded to the challenges of Luther. Luther had said in his 95 Theses in English that they are enemies of the church, of Christ, and of the Pope, who forbid the word of God to be preached at all in some churches in order that pardons may be preached in the others.
Mm.
They were so driven by a need to establish the church that they had forgotten to preach Christ. And Martin Luther saw this as a terrible, terrible thing. That if you heard, because we are in the connections tent, aren't we, David?
We are. We're in the connections tent.
If you remember what Steve said last night, that sometimes as Christians we can make the means the end.
The end.
And what had happened in Catholicism is building St. Peter's magnificent cathedral was seen as the primary purpose of the church of that
day. It became the end.
And Luther was offended by this, and he thought that preachers would leave the flock to go on recruitment missions to bring in the coins into the coffers. He thought that was a great tragedy. Injury is done the word of God when in the same sermon an equal or greater length is spent on pardons than on the word. Luther was horrified that the word that had transformed him, the just shall live by faith as he ascended Pilate's staircase, the word that had set him free was being not treated with responsibility. The custodianship and the stewardship that had been given to the church was not being held responsible.
Glenn, let me just say something about that too. It is a certainty that Luther did not understand what we are discussing. When we have the luxury of historical perspective and we can see the coalescence of the mess, the message, the means, and all of the various things that were happening economically, politically, socially, and in the arts, Luther almost certainly would not have understood that he would be regarded as crucially pivotal person in human history. He was a faithful Catholic. He was raising an in-house conversation that I think he genuinely believed would bring about a dialogue of goodwill, and they would sort through some of these theological issues. In other words, when he nailed those theses to the door, he thought they would be heard in Wittenberg and perhaps within the Catholic Church. Those hammer blows were heard all over the world and continue to resonate to this day.
And faithfulness in every generation looks like that.
Yes, it does.
Nobody wakes up in the morning and says, I want to change the world. I want to do something great for God. Those who are closest to Christ are unaware of the consequences of their actions. But
beautiful.
What great news it is, David, that if we are faithful, who knows what God will do from that widow's mite? Who knows what the ripple effect and the consequence of that will
be? When you just said that, it reminded me just briefly of things like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. It's a virtual certainty that they would not have known that we here now 2,000 plus years later would be reading and gaining encouragement. I mean, they just stood on the Plain of Dura and said, today we're not bowing. And that's here it. We take courage and strength. And that's a beautiful thing. I love that point about that's what faithfulness looks like.
Absolutely. And so Pope Leo, he issues his papal bull, and he says that we forbid every and all of the faithful to read, assert, preach, praise, print, publish, or defend the writings of Martin Luther. Instead of stimulating discussion, Luther had the authority of the church fall on his head in a way that he never anticipated. Yep. And so really this becomes the moment in the Reformation where Luther has to decide, will I press on or will I give in?
Capitulate to the
authority. It is sometimes much easier to give in, but God be praised that he didn't, David. God be praised that he held his ground. And there was a principle here that needed to be defended. And Luther, in response to the papal bulls, as recorded in the beautiful words of the Great Controversy, says, I cannot submit my faith either to the Pope or to the councils, because it is clear as day that they have frequently erred and contradicted each other. Unless, therefore, I am convinced by the testimony of Scripture or the clearest reasoning, unless I am persuaded by means of the passages I have quoted, and unless they thus render my conscience bound by the word of God, I cannot and I will not retract, for it is unsafe for a Christian to speak against his conscience. Here I stand, I can do no other. May God help me. Amen.
I don't know if it has the same effect on you, but every time I read those words, I get goosebumps.
Yeah.
There is something I was telling Glenn just before we came over, was that I have a PBS documentary, which is like the ABC of America. It's a public documentary, secular scholars and some sacred scholars as well, sympathetic to the Christian tradition, talking about the role of Martin Luther in Western civilization, not from a theological standpoint, but just who was this guy and what role did he play? And historian after historian affirms, secular historians, that this was a crucial moment. Yeah. And that Martin Luther introduced a whole new way of thinking about authority and thinking about liberty of conscience.
Yeah.
Because what you have here is a man who is choosing to not capitulate to an authority that everybody was willing to capitulate to, including kings and princes and queens.
You were at risk of death for not
at
doing
risk
so,
of death. And Luther knows that. And,
yes.
And this idea that here I stand, and even the secular historians recognize that there is a fulcrum here upon which Western civilization teeters, a whole new way of thinking about reality, that I will resist the overtures of this incomprehensibly large power. And we're that legacy is bequeathed to us. Today, we take liberty of conscience for granted.
We do.
But this was a radical, revolutionary notion in the days of Luther.
We have no idea what a privilege it is for us to live in a democratic
yes.
world where freedom of conscience is protected constitutionally in the Americans and certainly by legislation in Parliament in the greater Commonwealth nations. It is an awesome privilege that stands apart from the majority of history. We are living in an age which is very different from what many people throughout the ages have lived
very
in.
Very different from Luther's experience.
And it's actually quite interesting. We're talking about anniversaries and dates, 500 years since 1517. I think today's date is April 17, is that correct? And it was on April 17 that John Eck looked Luther in the eye and said that you need to recant, you need to repent.
500 years ago today.
496 years ago today.
496, thank you.
Today. Luther stated boldly that it is as clear as day that the popes and the ecumenical councils frequently err and contradict each other. And some people have derived, and even in Luther's day, there was anarchist tendencies that said, let's reject authority. Luther was never teaching the rejection of authority. Luther was as faithful to the church for as long as he could be. There is no seeds of anarchy in the teaching of the Protestant Reformation. But Luther's observation was valid, that when you look through history, you can see in his day and age, it was still raw that three popes had been competing for the same throne. The councils would frequently disagree with each other. Priests would frequently disagree with each other. And Luther said, we need an established authority that is robust, that is defendable, that will endure through the ages, that is applicable in culture and contextual variations. And Luther had it right. And we, as children of the Reformation, need to thank him
yes.
for making his stand, that unless something can be shown to be consistent with the Scriptures and with clear reasoning, then we must reject it. John Eck replied to Luther and tried to plug the defense of the authority of the church. He says, "You have resuscitated dogmas which have been distinctly condemned by these various councils, and you think that you are at liberty to bring back into the discussion points which have for ages been settled by the church and councils. And if you are free to challenge the authority of the church, nothing will be fixed. Everything will be fluid, and we will have no security and no certainty." And I have seen, even in today's contemporary religious environment, people from the Anglican Church and people from other churches fleeing back to Mother Rome because they love the consistency and the constancy and certainty of its teachings. Is it risky to have liberty of conscience? Is it
hugely risky?
Is it terrible to give people the ability to decide for themselves what is truth? It is. The sharpest knives do the most good, but they also do the greatest damage. And freedom of conscience must be held by us as a very, very precious commodity. We must not abuse that privilege.
In fairness to Rome's critique of Luther, they were operating in harmony with their basic presuppositions about knowledge.
Yeah.
They had come to the place where their epistemological bedrock, that is to say, the thing that was certain and unmovable and unshakable for them, was the traditions of the church. So in fairness to them, they were singing the party line. They were saying what they needed to say. What Luther perhaps naively didn't understand is that this little act of Banksy, I love that illustration, Glenn, that little act of nailing the theses to the door was not just an internal conversation. It would erupt into a conversation about what is the epistemological bedrock of how we know what we know about God, about the world, and about ourselves. And what's going to happen is Luther is going to introduce a whole radical idea, a new way of viewing how we know what we think we know. And he said, "Sola Scriptura, show me from the text," to which the Roman response is, no, that's not the conversation we're having. It's in the councils, it's in the creeds, it's in the edicts. Now you can see you have two people are playing two different games.
Yeah, the Roman Catholic Church, they believe in Sola Scriptura. The Sola Scriptura they believe in is that we have been given the keys of the kingdom by Jesus himself to Peter, and we are custodians and stewards of the truth. And it is your duty as a good Bible-believing scholar to recognize the authority that has been invested in us.
The authority of the church. It's the equivalent of somebody getting ready to play a game of basketball, and you know they're getting ready to shoot, and you've got some teams assembled, and then others come in and start kicking the ball. And say, "Hey, what are you doing?" "No, we're trying to kick a goal." "No, we're playing basketball." "No, we're playing soccer."
Yeah.
This game is not going to work. You're playing by two totally different sets of rules, two different goals.
Yes.
And Luther said, "No, this is a whole new rule set." He didn't know this. Naively in the beginning, he thought it would be, as you said, you used the word innocuous, a fairly innocuous in-house conversation, but it catalyzed a much larger conversation that we are living in the wake of today.
As you consider what Johann Eck said to Luther at the Diet of Worms, and as this challenge mounts up, you can hear echoes through the history of the Catholic Church a thousand years before. Back in the 5th century, there was a dialogue between a guy called Pelagius and Augustine. Augustine is the guy who kind of donated to the church a contentious doctrine of original sin, over which we've been wrestling and struggling ever since. He also made some fantastic contributions to church theology, and we mustn't assume that because he got some things very wrong, he didn't get anything really right. But there was a big discussion in Augustine's day, and because of Augustine's bent towards this idea that man is so depraved, that man is so evil, that man is so wicked, that it would be incapable of any man or woman to even want to consider
to
the option that Jesus was attractive or that his life or her life needed to be changed.
Just going to press pause there briefly, Glenn. Hold that thought. Just so we're clear, Augustine is 1,000 years before the time of Luther. 1,000 years before. What we're talking about here is the seeds of what Luther was coming up against were planted a millennium before.
Yes. It is the precedent that really laid the foundation for the argument that was happening at the time of the Reformation. And Pelagius was a guy who came along and said, "You know what? I think that there is capacity within mankind to choose. I think that free will is exactly that. It's free will." And Augustine said, "No, there can be no such thing as free will. Unless God decided on your behalf that you could decide for yourself, You couldn't decide at all. It's circular logic, and it's difficult. And David, I'm sure, as I have, that every person who is interested in the Bible, every person that is interested in historical theology, immerses themselves in trying to, how can we best describe the tension between God's election and our free will? And we will look at that as we work through this week. But in the time of the great argument, 1,000 years before the time of the Reformation, between Pelagius and Augustine, they had several church councils, and after 2 or 3 decades of discussion, Augustine made this famous saying, and David, your Latin is so much better than mine. what can you say that for me in
Latin?
He says,
Roma locuta causa finita.
In other words, in plain English, Rome speaks, matter settled. The church council speaks, the matter is settled. And in a sense, you can see how essential that is for unity. And we within our own church, in our own context.
Be careful.
Yeah, I won't go there. Another day.
I'd love to have that conversation. We'll have it later in the week.
Yeah, righto.
I got to reel you in. You reel me in, righto. I'll reel you in.
Okay, sounds good. Sola Scriptura. Sola Scriptura does not mean nuda Scriptura. Nuda Scriptura sounds a little bit provocative.
Next slide, please.
Nuda Scriptura is Latin for naked Scripture. The Reformation was not teaching naked Scripture. They were not saying that we have the freedom, as one patient who turned up in my chair to have their wisdom teeth extracted, and I said, I've never seen you before, I've never heard of you, who told you about me, where did you come from? They said, we opened the phone book, we dropped a compass, and it landed on your name. God showed us that you're the person to take our wisdom teeth out. Thank goodness I was able to get them out. They're a memorable event. But that is not the way we want to use the Bible. We don't want to take the text of the Bible out of its cultural context, out of its historical context, out of its grammatical context. We don't just believe that the words of the Scripture are inspired to the point that we can pluck them like flowers and place them in any vase of our choosing to decorate according to any theme that we intend on. The words of the Scripture must be considered in context. They must be seen in their cultural setting.
Okay, good. You said exactly what I was going to say.
Prima Scriptura is another version of Scripture where the Reformers did not believe in Prima Scriptura, which essentially says that of all of the multitudes of authority, we accept the authority of the church, we accept the authority of culture, we accept the authority of the views of theologians, but primary amongst all those authorities, we will take the Scripture. The Reformers rejected this idea that the Scriptures were a competitor amongst a multitude of authority figures. For them, they believed sola scriptura. They wanted their authority to be based firmly and solidly on the Word of God. They wanted the text in context to be taken and study and prayer be given to try and to extract from the text the truth that was present for their day. Really, when it comes down to it, sola scriptura is a insight into that big word that David used, the epistemological challenge that we all face is how do we know what we need to know? Jesus, when he came to this earth, he was mingling with the Pharisees and the Sadducees who were scholars in the word.
Yep.
They had memorized the Torah. Their passion for scriptural truth began from the cradle to the grave. And Jesus found that even though these people had such a high regard for Scripture, they had completely missed the point. And as we want to bring to the fore in the first of our 5 solas, the idea that Scriptures must be our primary source of authority, I want to segue now into giving David a run to talk about a little bit more about the application of what that means. But I can't finish by giving the challenge to the church that I love and to myself. What is our hermeneutic? How do we understand Scripture? Is it there just so that we can win a moral argument with our Protestant cousins? Is it there so that we can act intelligent in a secular world that has forgotten what is in the Bible and what isn't in the Bible? Or is it a life-changing principle? How do we read it? How can we understand the Bible truth? I just want to share this one comment with you, and then I'm going to hand over to David. We all know this quote so well. None but those who have fortified their minds with the truths of the Bible will stand through the last great conflict. You're familiar with that passage?
Mm.
As Adventists, we love the word, but I want you to understand in context what Ellen White is really saying. What is the big point? It is not just merely to read the Bible and to memorize it and to have it there in our armamentarium. The Bible is there for a purpose. And what is the purpose? Ellen White wants us to be able to endure the trial before us. She wants us to understand the will of God as revealed in His Word. She wants us to honor Him. And how can we honor Him? Only as we have a right conception of His character, of His government, of His purpose, and that we act in accordance with them. As we journey through these five solas, we want that to be a reality for the church in North New South Wales. We want a practical truth that will help us both to believe and to behave better. We don't want to engage in mere intellectual exercises. We want a practical, powerful, and persuasive propositional platform. Was that all right?
Wow. That was amazing.
Yeah, that's not David Asscherick standard, but do you realize how intimidating it is to stand next to this guy?
Bite your tongue.
Oh, man. He's been praying all morning that the truth is clearly presented. I'm just praying that I'll get a word in.
Clearly, he's up to the task.
Anyway, it's David's turn, and we're going to let him take over and go through a little bit more about the practical truths, and I'll see if I can pay him back.
That'd be great. Thank you so much, Glenn. So, just a few slides back, you don't have to go back, but you had that question there, that pivotal, seminal question that Jesus put to the religious leaders of his day when he was repeatedly questioned on various things. How readest thou? And Jesus was not shy to affirm people when they gave the right answer.
Absolutely, you have
answered
well. What's
the great commandments? And he's, the great commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and the second is like it, to love your neighbors yourself. And Jesus would say, you have answered well.
Yeah.
But here's the point. When we take Scripture and Scripture alone, Scripture is an historical document, or actually better said, it's a series of historical documents transcending some 1,500 years of human history written on three continents by perhaps as many as 41 or 42 different authors. We cannot just lift Scripture out and then just go drop it in 2017 Australia and say, well, the text means what it says. Well, yes, the text means what it says, but the question is, what did the text mean then? And only when we first know what the text meant can we then begin to answer the question, what does the text mean? Now, just a moment ago, you accused me of using a big word, epistemological. What about the word you just dropped, hermeneutic?
It's a great hermeneutic. Word.
That's a great word. How many people here, raise your hands, you do not know what the word hermeneutic means? Raise your hand. There we go. See, look. How many people don't know what the word epistemological means? See, I win. The word hermeneutic, actually here's a really great way to remember what the word hermeneutic means. It just means interpretation. But the etymology of the word is it came from the god Hermes, right? The Greek god Hermes, who was the deliverer and interpreter of divine messages. So you have that word there, that name, Hermes, hermeneutic. Your hermeneutic and my hermeneutic is how do we interpret Scripture? Not how do we read it. We know how to read it, right? If it's in German, we read it in German. If it's in English, we read it in English. If it's in Latin, we read it in Latin. Okay, yeah, we can read the text, but the question that Jesus was putting to the Pharisees and the scribes, and in a way, the question that Luther and the others that followed in his wake, the question was, how do we interpret the text? Yes, surely the keys of the kingdom were given to the church. What does that mean? You can't just pluck that Matthew chapter 16 passage up and drop it in the medieval church and say, there it is. You know, matter settled. Rome has spoken, the matter is settled. Luther and those that followed after him began to ask the question, yeah, but not what does that say, but what does that mean? Okay, and I want to say something that's a little radical. The Bible does not mean what it says.
No.
It means what it means.
Yeah.
By the way, if you're married, you understand this. Am I wrong or am I right?
You're right.
Right? My wife will say something and I'll behave in a certain way and she'll get upset with me and then she'll say, I'll say, but baby, I said. Or she'll say, I said. And then she'll come back with, yeah, but that's not what I meant. Right? We all have our own little intermarital hermeneutic. And when Jesus says, how do you read? He puts the question to us, how do we interpret an ancient document? And then just bring it into 2017 Australia or 16th century Europe. How does that happen? Well, there are a variety of ways to approach Scripture. What we'd like to highlight here today are just two of those ways to approach Scripture. Probably two of the maybe best known, but certainly the most popular. The first is what's called the historical critical method. Now, in the historical critical method, what's happening is that scholars, and in some cases liberal theologians, are coming to the Word, they're coming to the Bible, and they're approaching it from a platform of skepticism or at least apathy. They're saying, look, we are not concerned about the divine claims, the religious claims, the inspiration claims. We're just treating this as an historical document, which, by the way, there's a place for that.
Yeah.
There is absolutely a place to approach Scripture as an historical document, whether it's archaeological or contextual or whatever. There's a place for that. But the historical critical method assumes a platform of skepticism, and they often advocate what's called the demythologization of Scripture, which basically means all of those miracles didn't really happen. Those were just allegories or stories or perhaps exaggerations. So what we're going to do is we're going to extract, you know, the feeding of the 5,000, the walking on water, the virgin birth, the parting of the Red Sea. None of that stuff actually happened, but there's a truth contained in these fantastic stories.
It's like Aesop's fables, really.
Aesop's
it?
Fables, exactly.
Yeah.
So in the higher critical method, you come from a platform of skepticism, from a platform of doubt, and you make the assumption that this is not really believable, especially not in the scientific age in which we live, okay? And there are a number, in fact, the majority of mainstream Protestants would embrace at some level the historical critical method of interpretation, okay? Now, the other method there is the historical grammatical method, and the historical grammatical method, yes, says, yes, historical context, as you mentioned, Scripture is clothed in an historical context, but we take not a critical posture, but a grammatical posture. What does the text say? What's the grammar? What's the language? Now, just a word on that. We take, as believers, Seventh-day Adventists, are firmly rooted in the historical grammatical approach to Scripture. Do we take Scripture seriously as Seventh-day Adventists?
Absolutely.
Let me just say a word here. From the time of Luther, and we'll tease this out over the next 4 days, from the time of Luther, to go from 1517 to 2017, that doesn't happen in a moment. The reason that the Protestant Reformation has taken 500 years is that, in the inimitable words of John Robinson, quoted in The Great Controversy, there's no way the church could come out of such thick anti-Christian darkness in a moment. Right? Think of it as a kind of spiritual obesity, right? If you become very obese, that doesn't happen in a day, it doesn't happen in a week, it doesn't happen, you know, in a year. To become very obese takes a lot of cumulative putting on of weight, right? You're getting really big. Now, if you want to take that weight off, it doesn't happen in an afternoon, right? No. Much to our, you know, dismay. You have to take almost the same amount of time, in some cases more time, to get that weight off than you did to get it on. Well, think this through. From the time of the rise of the medieval church, and we'll just attach a date here, roughly the middle of the 6th century, and we're down now to the middle of the 16th century, the beginning of the 16th century, that's 1,000 years. So you got 1,000 years of putting spiritual obesity on, and it's not just going to disappear in a moment. If William Miller or Ellen White or Joseph Bates or David Asscherick or Doug Batchelor had showed up in the days of Luther and said the things that we say now, they would have been totally misunderstood. It was not possible to just transition from that to today, that full knowledge of truth would come immediately. It's incremental. It's what, everyone? Incremental. And that incremental process, I'm sorry, I can't stand still, Glenn.
I'm switching
you up here.
I was thinking of going and sitting on the piano stool.
Don't do it.
Okay.
It has required great men and women, and we as Seventh-day Adventists stand firmly in the Protestant tradition. Sometimes we behave in ways that make us think that we're almost, dare I say it, we behave in almost cultic ways. We think that we just suddenly, you know, popped onto the scene of history. Oh, no, 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 no. We are the inheritors of Luther and of Calvin and of Huss and of Zwingli and of Melanchthon and of Wesley and of Williams and of Miller. And without that chain that we'll be discussing more thoroughly in the next, you couldn't get to where we are today, but the question is still put to us today that Jesus put 2,000 years ago. How do you read the text? And Seventh-day Adventists have answered that question like this. We take Scripture seriously.
Yeah, we do.
We take Scripture. How seriously do we take it? Well, here are some examples of how Seventh-day Adventists take Scripture seriously and in a way that causes us to be regarded and marginalized as ridiculous. Let's be honest.
Actually, okay? David said something which I've never forgotten, and he said, you can often judge how good your truth is by those who hate you.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Al Pacino, he famously said, you can tell a lot about a man by looking at who wants him dead.
Yes.
Right? And there are people who would love to see the Seventh-day Adventist Church disappear. For reason, we come off as flat earthers. I mean, like literally that level of absurdity in the minds of many with things like this. For example, creation Sabbath. The majority of the Christian world, though not all, the majority of the Christian world, at least at the scholarly level, the academic level, has jettisoned the idea of a literal six-day creation that took place in the thousands, not millions. But Seventh-day Adventists, are we committed to a literal six-day creation?
We have
what
to
we
be.
Say is, the text says. Yeah. Now, the response is, yeah, but science says, to which we respond and say, but that's not science that's saying it. That's not evidence that's saying it. That's interpretation that's saying it.
That's exactly right.
We approach, epistemologically, the geologic column or the earth, and we see evidences of the flood. We see evidences of global catastrophism, but that is not what, you know, the secular geologist sees or the paleontologist sees. They are viewing reality through a different lens. And when we say, but our lens is Scripture,
yeah.
Sola Scriptura, we take this book seriously. Even among our own brothers and sisters in the faith, this is regarded as fundamentalist. Has that become a bit of a buzzword?
Bad word.
Fundamentalist. Yeah. And so on things like creation, the Sabbath, we are committed to the Sabbath, and I'll go so far as to say, the day that the Seventh-day Adventist Church gives up the Sabbath, first of all, is the day that I leave, if that ever happened, and second of all, it will be the day that we have become confused about creation,
yeah.
Because these are inexorably, intimately linked. Marriage is a conversation that's taking place right now. We say, but the text says, a man and a woman, not polygamy, not polyamorous relationships. There are a variety of relationships that we say, yes, we're not saying that you don't love that person. What we're saying is that God has given us a prescription, and that prescription is male, female, monogamous, and lifelong. We're committed to it. We're committed to what the text... Are we committed to what the text says?
Yes, please.
We are. Another one that we probably will pick up a little bit later in the week is on the state of the dead. Now, you might be thinking that what really matters in the state of the dead is that when you die, you sleep and you await the resurrection. I want to tell you, that truth, and it is true.
It is true.
The truth of when you die, you sleep is the tip of a much larger iceberg.
Can I throw in a couple of big words?
Throw them out there.
Yeah, look, come on. Platonic dualism. We all understand that, don't we?
I wasn't even going to say it, but now that you've said it, there is an iceberg of stability to the state of the dead. What you believe, if you just have a very reasonable, simple, biblical faith that you believe when you die, you sleep and you're resurrected, that's awesome. But I want you to know, there is a gigantic amount of philosophical, logical, and theological stability to why you believe that. And it comes down to this idea that mankind is not naturally immortal, that we don't possess immortality. That is something that is given to us as a gift. You mentioned Platonic dualism. It's the Greek idea that matter is temporal and bad, and immaterial things, such as the spirit, are not made of matter, immaterial, and are good, right? And there's an eternality to them. We are committed, even in the face of many Christians who take Scripture seriously, but their approach is different. That's the key. If you were to say to them, do you believe in sola scriptura? What would they say?
Absolutely.
They say, yes, we believe in sola scriptura. But then Jesus' question, how readest thou? And Seventh-day Adventists approach Scripture in a way that is frankly very conservative theologically. Now, I want to share something with you that's awesome. Look at this statement here from Ellen White, one of my very favorite of her voluminous statements, fifth volume of the Testimonies, page 331. She says, the Bible with its precious gems of truth was not written for the scholar alone. I have a question for you. Was the Bible written for the scholar? Yeah, I hear a lot of no's. No, the Bible was written for the scholar, but it was not written for the scholar alone. There is a depth, and a depth of, I have a good friend of mine who just finished his third PhD, and he did his PhD on Colossians 2:16.
Wow.
One verse, 8 years of study. There is a depth here, yeah. Right? A depth here. So is the Bible for the scholar?
Yes.
But it's not for the scholar
alone.
Alone. Look at this. This is so encouraging. I love this democratization of theology. Look at this. On the contrary, it was designed for the, say it with me, two words.
Common people.
Common people, and I love this part. And the interpretation given by the common people, when aided by the Holy Spirit, accords best with the
truth
as it is in Jesus. The great truths necessary for salvation are made clear as the noonday. and none will mistake and lose their way except those who follow their own judgment instead of the plainly revealed word of God. When Luther began his protest, he sent a snowball racing down the hill that became a giant ball that included not only the arts and not only theology and not only ecclesiology. It actually brought about the emergence of a different kind of middle class, not an economic middle class, but a theological middle class. And it was this idea that we don't need a theologian. Not that we're not happy to have theologians. We were just discussing some of our favorite theologians this morning. But that you, builder, painter, tradie, teacher, accountant, whatever you, who you are, 17-year-old, that you can come to Scripture, and this is key, open up these words, these ancient, inspired, amazing words, and pray this prayer. Father in heaven, I am willing to be willing. Yeah. Show me something about yourself, and if you reveal something to me, make me obedient to it. Give me understanding. Show me something about myself, about you, and about the world. In Jesus' name, amen. And you can read the text and come away with, what does she say? A correct understanding. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Because you have come away with a correct or a truthful understanding does not mean you have plumbed the depths of what's in that particular passage, but it's true nonetheless. And the radical tectonic thing that Luther introduced was the democratization of theology and of access to God. We don't need the priests, we don't need the cardinals, we don't need the prelates, we don't need the popes. You can come to Scripture and to the God of Scripture because of Jesus. By the Spirit.
Yeah.
Well, all of a sudden, you've got a whole church that's kind of out of business. Right? What are they doing now? And Luther did not anticipate that what he was initiating would bring about the Reformation as you and I now know and love it. Friends, we commend to you today Scripture. Scripture. You don't have to know the word epistemological or Platonic dualism, or you don't have to understand even the word hermeneutic. In whatever level of sophistication you are at, you can open these words, these precious blood-stained words, these expensively purchased words, and yes, your phone is important, and the internet is important, and all life, all these things that get our attention are important, but friends, nothing is more important than coming to God through Christ in Scripture. Yeah. Make that a priority. Don't let the words and the courage and the bravery and the actions of the Protestants and of Jesus himself, of course, don't let that be in vain for you. Treasure this word, love this word, cling to this word, study this word, wrestle with this word. Yeah. Come to the place where you say, I don't understand that. That doesn't make sense to me. I'm confused. It's okay. God's not threatened by your confusion. He's not threatened by your doubts. He's not threatened by your insecurities. You can come openly, honestly, and vulnerably to God and say, God, I want to understand this, but not just for the purpose of understanding it. I want to understand you. And friends, I commend to you, and Glenn commends to you, Sola Scriptura, the text of Scripture. We are standing in the shadow, the giant shadow cast not only by Calvary, but by Luther. And to the degree that you take Scripture seriously and you make it a part of your life, you are an inheritor of the Protestant tradition, and to the degree that it sits dustily, lazily on your shelf, you are not an inheritor of that tradition, perhaps intellectually, but not truly inheriting the tradition that's been bequeathed to you by brave men and women over the last 500 years. Glenn, I'm going to give you the last word.
Yeah, thanks, David. We promised that we would have a conversation, and we will have one, but with respect to Cameron, who I think is following us in 2 minutes, save your questions for tomorrow. And David and I will talk faster. We'll make sure we...
Or maybe, this is a radical idea, less.
Yeah. Yeah,
Glenn, go ahead.
Great. Hey, look, it's been really exciting today. I just have to say that truth is not truth until it becomes personal. And for me, the study of the Scripture has been the joy of my life, mining its treasures, digging its depths. And the deeper you dig, David, you know this yourself, the more you realize that there's just an infinite beyond. Throughout the ceaseless ages of eternity, the character of God, His love, His passion... His desire to see lost sinners redeemed, restored, reclaimed. What
Thank
themes
you,
they are, and we need to consider them. And it would be sad if we lived in a church where the Bible for us became a historical art piece that adorns our mantelpiece. We need to love it. We need to live it. We need to learn it. And as we close this meeting in prayer, I challenge you to come back tomorrow, bring a friend. Connection tent, we've got chairs like way outside the tent boundaries. We'll see if we can do the same here.
Well, this is the connection.
Well, yeah.
By faith. We walk by faith.
Absolutely. Let's just close with a word of prayer. Father God, you have given us Jesus. You have revealed in him most clearly what you are like. But you have also given us the testimony, the record of those who touched and handled and spent time with him. We have the more sure word of prophecy. Lord, the unfolding of your narrative from the beginning of creation till the close of this earth's history. Mm. It's all there for our benefit, for our edification, for our encouragement, to challenge us, Lord, to even prick us,
yes,
and to hurt us in order, yes, that you may heal. And I pray that these words that have come through at the cost of blood, sweat, and tears, would not be handled or, yes, held by us in contempt or without taking seriously,
please,
the treasure we have. This, Lord, is our prayer for the glory of Jesus, and in his name, amen.